groovy. Can you dig it? Fantastic, everybody. That was Blue Oyster Cult. In the presence of another world. Right on. KTLK. TheFringe.fm. Digital network. Right, Dave?
For sure.
Oh, yeah. Trying to add Eric in. He's got a Bigfoot story for us, too. And what's going on, Eric? I tried adding you. You keep saying in the chat room you got this big story, and now everyone wants to hear it, and I think he's got cold feet or something. What's going on, man? Let's try him again. Oh, I think I got something here.
Yes.
Eric? There we go.
Yes, he's a...
Here he is. Here he is, everybody. All right.
A man barely alive. We can rebuild him, though. We can make him better than he was before.
Oh,
we just need about $6 million in 1980 money, and we can make it happen.
Well, we just have to get Donald Trump to sponsor our show.
I think Dave's got all the money. Dave Cruz, he's just hoarding it. He's pretending like he doesn't, but I just suspect that he does.
I'm drinking it away right now as we speak.
Nice.
Deb, she's the master. Rings in the background.
She controls the amount the next of drinking.
On the mansion in Hawaii, on the Maui Island.
Does she throw the hammer down when you drink too much?
No.
Blast me, man. It's blast me.
Bigfoot dudes were still on. That one dude was he had me intrigued.
Yeah, he was great. The first David, yeah, that was great, eh?
Well, the other guy was cool too. We need to get those guys back for an extended period of time because I wanted to spin some stuff at them, but now they're gone.
Well, yeah, what I'll do is I'll get them on a Sunday. What I'm going to do is probably have to switch my show to Sunday afternoon. I don't really have a choice until I can quit my day job.
But you're 3 hours ahead of Dave and I's time, so that would be like maybe around 7 o'clock your time, or is it got to be earlier than that so we can get it on before Dave's show on Sundays?
Yeah, what time's your show on Sunday?
Well, right now it's on 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific, but it's going to be changing to 9 to midnight Pacific on April 1st.
Cool.
Okay, no, but don't you do a Sunday show too?
Yeah, but right now during March it's only Sundays, but it's going to be Saturday and Sunday starting in April.
Okay, and yeah, I was thinking 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time for my Sunday show.
That would work.
Is that going to interfere? Yeah, it'll be a three-hour show.
Gap. No, there'd be a gap.
When does yours start, Dave, again? Sorry.
Oh, not till 7.
7 Eastern, or what time zone?
It'll be 10 o'clock in your time,
Pacific.
So you're waiting.
Always,
okay, so there'll be an hour gap in between. Yeah. All right, that's groovy. That works, because I have to go to work that night, so I want to get it over with a little bit early before I go to work. But that's all right. That'll work out all right. So what was your story, Eric?
Okay, so this is, to me, it's interesting, because it has like a history. I'll try to make it kind of brief. So in February,
go ahead. We got lots of time, man. Explain it in detail.
Okay, cool. All right. Well, so February last year, Dave's heard the story. I don't know if he's heard this part of the story, but he's heard. Okay, February last year, I went to my first conference. Big Bear, the Big Bear conference, Alien Snowfest. I was gonna meet Jimmy and Rita and all that. Mike Haynes and Ben Friedman, Linda Moulton Howe. I mean, it was awesome. And Whitley Strieber drove up, you know, because I guess his wife had just passed recently, before a year ago, and so he came up there. But anyway, there was this group of people, this Indian tribal group that were Native American Indians that were in this back area, away from where the conference was actually happening, where the stage was and the seating was, kind of around the corner. And that's where people would set up their books, you know, all the different vendors. Stan was there selling his books, and Richard Dolan, and everybody had their little table. And this other group from Dulce is how they pronounce it in the Indian tongue. It's Dulce, New Mexico. And so I was, you know, I was hanging out back there with those guys for a little while. And I, you know, and this one guy, I started talking to him. Turns out his name, he asked me not to say his name, so I'll respect that. But in the future, maybe he'll come forward. But anyway, so he's a shaman. He's an older guy. He's probably somewhere close to 70. And so he lives, his family, his native tribe, his immediate family has property and farming territory right there at the base of the Dulce, New Mexico mountain, the famous mountain that's been speculated where there's, you know, you heard of the story where, what was it, Philip Schneider went in and they had a firefight and he went down to the, into the seven, there's like seven levels and there's all sorts of, you know, humans and reptilians and whatnot kind of working together in tandem at these different levels, you know, doing this crazy, I mean, it's a crazy story, but if you listen to Philip Schneider tell the story on the YouTube videos, it seems very believable. So anyway, so I'm not going to say that that did or didn't happen. But the point is this Indian tribe, they live there right at the base of this mountain. And so the guy was telling us a story over a year ago that he has seen a silver disc come out from basically out from the mountain, you know, up on the top of the mountain, kind of come up above, float down. And then kind of, and then apparently there's a lake or a river, a small river that runs through like a little running, trickling kind of stream that runs through the base of the mountain. And so this particular object came down and it floated, and he was watching it, and then it just kind of floated along, and then it went into, we'll call it a river, and disappeared. So he told that story to me, and I thought, wow, this is an amazing story. I believe this guy because, I mean, my experience is the Native American Indians, they don't make shit up. I mean, they got a story to tell. They don't like to tell stories. They don't like to tell stories to white guys. They don't trust the white man, but he decided to trust me because I actually did. I'll tell you what I told this guy, and I think, and I meant it from my heart. I said to him that I felt bad. I mean, I was, you know, raised in an era where this did not occur, but obviously we all know about the cowboys and the Indians. We kind of all know that the cowboys came in and stole the land from the Indians. They just basically stole them. They killed them, they slaughtered them, they stole their land. And so now it's U.S. government territory, and then the U.S. government is allowing the Indians in some of these areas to stay in this area, in their areas, and so on and so forth. But the bottom line is I told him that I, as a white man, even though I wasn't there and I wasn't part of it, I wanted to apologize on behalf of our race that I thought that what happened to his people and his race was wrong and that, you know, it wouldn't happen in today's modern day era. You know, I just, what happened back in the day was just wrong. And he felt that, and he thought, you know, this guy's coming from his heart. And he actually shed a tear, and I shed a tear because I, you know, I just felt bad. I just felt bad that what, you know, what we've done to the Indians and the land that we've stolen. And anyway, so we kind of connected, and I told him that I wanted to come and visit him. I wanted to come and see him and hang out with him on his land. And he's a shaman, and he wanted to. And I asked him if I could go with him when he goes out and does his shamanic healings because he is the shamanic doctor. Some people call them the witch doctor or whatever. The point is he kind of works in that area in the Dulce Mountain area, and he does his shamanic healings for the tribal people and whoever else. And he said that he would allow me to come there. And
is he able to make shoes for Bigfoot?
They're working on it. They're actually, here, we're going to get to that part next. So anyway, so he says, come on up. And then, of course, you know, time went by. Life happened, things happened. I wasn't able to go and visit him last year. And then in Arizona this year at the UFO Congress, I showed up and I didn't know he was going to be there. And there he was, you know, at the booth with the same people that he was there last time. And so we kind of reconnected. And then he told me a story. And this is the story that I mean, it's I believe that what he told me was true because he was very adamant. He says, you know, do not ever repeat this story and use my name in conjunction with it because my tribal people will not appreciate this. He says, this is a tribal story that we like to keep private. So here's what he said about the Bigfoot. He said that he has seen the Bigfoot three times in the Dulce, New Mexico area where their family farm is. And it's tradition there that, for example, they have their farming. And what they do, okay, and to keep the Bigfoot, and this, I'm not making a joke, this may sound funny, but this is what they do. To keep the Bigfoot from coming in to their farming area during the farming season and stealing their food, okay, which they do apparently, is they, okay, they go around the area where the farm is, and they find all the trees, and the Indian people will pee on the tree. But they don't just pee anywhere on the tree. They pee up high on the tree. And I says, well, why? Why are you peeing up high on the tree? He says, because the Bigfoot, when it comes down during a certain time of the year to take the food, you know, to steal their food, basically, that if they smell the urine, of the human urine on the tree, and it's up high, it's higher than they are, that somehow, however that affects the Bigfoot, that's a signal to them that they do not go to that area and steal food in that particular farming area because it's kind of a deterrent. And I just thought that was a fascinating story. I mean, I've never heard that before. So I was going to try to run it by your guys that were on earlier. If anyone's ever heard a story like that, or if that, I'd be interested in knowing. Have you ever heard a story like that, any of you guys?
No, I just usually just sneak up on them and piss right on their leg. Yeah. Why not?
Or their face. That works too.
Face.
Bigfoot likes golden showers, I heard.
Oh, God. I think we kind of went into Cheryl's there for a second.
Well, yeah. The guy, here's what he told me. He said May is the time of the year when they come down.
Is that Kurt?
Yeah, Kurt's there.
Hello? You're Kurt, finally.
Hey, no!
Kurt, you're there. We hear you.
Oh, my you're Lord. There.
Yeah, we can hear you, man.
I have a brand
Kurt,
new computer.
Kurt, how you doing, man? This is Dave Cruz.
Hey, Dave Cruz. How are you?
From
this new computer model, I'm like 1985 floppy disk computer wise, and I finally got this figured out. But anyway, I'm so sorry.
You didn't
throw
that Windows 10 literally out the window, Kurt.
Oh well, I'm telling you to get the audio working. Shoot,
hey, what,
go get yourself an iPad, Kurt.
What did the iPad? For what did the hard disk? What did the hard disk say to the floppy disk?
Should go to bed now.
Yeah.
Oh no, this is when you should stick around.
How are you all? How do you do? Are you?
So, yeah, good. I can tell you a little Bigfoot story myself.
Oh, Bigfoot.
Yeah, we're talking
I was
Bigfoot.
Cursing
man.
All through your stories. How pathetic. Blurry, blurry, blurry pictures all through the 70s and 80s, even today. Polaroid one-step shaky pictures, and I can't believe you all believe that there's really a Bigfoot. How pathetic. That's just wrong. That's wrong. And then some of you said you're Christian and believe in Bigfoot. How pathetic. You're
what's the difference? Hey, wait a minute, Kurt. What's the difference, Kurt, if you're Christian, Muslim, or atheist and you believe in Bigfoot? I don't see any difference, man.
Kurt, you're wrong.
Well, how do you know that, Kurt?
I'll come pick your ass up in Phoenix and take you there and show you.
I'll tell you something.
Blurry pictures. Could you get a clear picture for one?
I'll take you to meet you and let you meet the fucker.
Hey, Father Guido, can you come over here with that baby Bigfoot and you show Kurt about this?
Picture. Oh.
All right. I was going to do this anyways. Kurt, you don't want to think that these are Sasquatch. They're spiritual creatures, and they actually want me to baptize one of their babies.
I'm not kidding.
They bring them into the castle here.
Bigfoot. How pathetic. Blurry pictures all my life. Just blurry images of a hairy man off in the distance.
All right, I got it. This is
better than that. All my life. Oh, my life.
Here is a baby Bigfoot right here.
Look.
You don't believe it.
The cameras.
Okay, we're going to baptize the baptizer, the baby Bigfoot. Get in the water. Come on. Get down in there. Get in there. Uh-oh. Oh, shoot. His head will blow up like an alien.
They have the best cameras nowadays and still just a blurry fucking image off of it. I can't believe that.
I heard Kurt drop the bomb. It's a rarity here. To record that and send put it in your loop there.
Please.
Kurt in rare form.
Erase that. Erase that forever.
Yeah, Eric, your Skype's freaking out. I'm not sure what's going on there. How are you calling in, Eric?
2017 blurry pictures.
It was called the garble distorted.
Oh.
Well, you know, Kurt, I suggest you get put a cow costume on and go wait in the pasture, and maybe you'll see a Bigfoot.
Put a what on?
A cow? Yeah, cow costume, because it's dual purpose. You might get abducted,
We don't have. Do you have cow costumes in Canada? We don't do that here.
No. Oh, man. You need another person to go in the back end for you. And just don't eat too many beans before you go in there.
And then I'll have a... What, should I have a pull away one step to take a blurry picture, too?
Yeah, you got to have a camera on the cow, you know.
Press the button and then...
You might end up...
You have to shake it. Shake it like a Polaroid picture.
Yeah, you want to see if you might see a cattle mutilation, or it could be a
play that.
Oh shit, Kurt's in rare form tonight. I love it.
My Lord,
I think we should bring. I think we need to bring Willie in early tonight. I'm just. I love Willie, and we just, the Willie flavor. We need Willie.
Willie's asleep. He drank too much.
No, Willie's in the box. He's ready to go.
No, he's not.
Yes, he's eating enchiladas, and he's.
Oh yeah, he's right there. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Maybe Willie could eat enchiladas on the air. Tonight, Kurt.
He's just gonna curse, and f word this and that.
No, he's turned a new leaf. Turned a new leaf.
I think he ought to be a preacher one day, myself. He got the balls. He could really tell about Jesus one day. Really get his act together.
You know what? If you want to hear an interesting story from Willie, ask him about his mother. Because I believe his mother was... I'm not sure if he's going to be upset if I tell it. Maybe I should let him say it. But yeah,
he ought to be a preacher.
Well, he comes from a very religious upbringing, put it that way.
Does he?
Yes, he does. His mother was involved with the church.
I've got to get to a speaker. Hold on. Really? So I knew, because I know he'd know my Lord in his gut, I can feel that he'd know my Lord.
So, and you don't think that we'll be able to electrocute him tonight, then?
Yeah, you should. That'll find gold, you need fire. And when he curses like that, like I used to do before I knew my Lord, you need some lightning, so just fucking do it twice as hard.
Oh.
You need to get all that bad stuff out of him.
My Lord, Kurt, you're out of control.
He's got a lot of bad stuff in him.
My God, I'm gonna have to get my sensor button out for you.
Spirit of Willie.
Just shock him like 3 times and help him.
Yeah.
Help him. Be a preacher.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to get my sensor sound. My sensor beep is out because of your foul tongue there, Kurt.
Did I? What, foul tongue?
Oh, yeah, you let the F-bomb slide.
I'm sorry, Lord. You know what? My Lord made the F-bomb. My Father God that created all the planets.
He created Bigfoot, too.
He blew Jupiter. He said they're going to be the word fuck. So my Father... He did. He did, too.
Oh, God. I can't wait till the whole family mix on this show.
Thank you, Father. Man.
Kurt's just dropping damn.
He's going to get me kicked off the network.
I'm sorry.
The fucking F-bomb.
I might have to electrocute Kurt.
Do you think that Jesus ever said that when he turned the tables over in that temple when they were selling birds? Do you think he might have said fuck one time? I think. One time.
Maybe when he kicked the tables over in the temple.
Yes.
He might have said it then.
My Lord said fuck. He said, oh, you... white trash, Pete. What do you think you're doing? Selling birds in the church? Oh, fuck. Of course, it's all the F words, all right. Once in a while.
I don't know.
I'm so sorry. I should go away. Bye.
No. Wait. Before you leave.
You're fine, man. Don't worry about it.
Before, no, Kurt, we love you, baby.
It's all right. It's not that bad.
We can save
that for the second show, though.
Girl. You know, Madonna, my girl.
I don't mind it on the second show. On this show, if you say it again, then it's going to get one of these. Yeah. How'd you like that, Kurt?
Do it again. That was good. Do it one more time.
Okay.
That was good.
Ah, Jesus. Oh, jeez. Not that button. That was me. Shit. Okay, ready, Kurt?
Yes, I'm ready.
You have the power.
Do you remember Bionic Woman when she had the episode with the Sasquatch and it was
and it was like really intelligent.
Bigfoot, and they had something in his brain that made him do things.
That's
awful.
Right. It was Andre the Giant.
Oh yeah.
It was fake. Oh,
I never thought I'd have to electrocute you, Kurt, but you don't. You know, I was kind of hoping that you'd actually scream in your own voice when I did that, because it would have been better radio if you would have yelled yourself.
Okay.
Yeah. Next time I do it, can
do
you
do it again? Let's do a trial run, Wolf. Do it again.
Okay. Ready, Kurt? Here we go. This is going to be you. You got to scream.
Okay, here we go.
3, 2, 1. Legs in the air.
All you gotta do is scream like a girl, man. It's real easy.
Nah, won't happen.
Just pretend you saw a Bigfoot.
What's awful is that my parents can hear me in yonder.
Yeah, well, you know,
laying down, and I know that my voice echoes.
You mean you?
Like, what is doing? I know.
So you let the cat out of the bag. You live with your folks.
I came back to live with them because Dad has cancer. And mom,
that's different.
80, and I'm in a separate off. We built this partition on with my own kitchen and bathroom and room.
Okay, I got a shout out here. I got a shout out. This is one of the guests. A new follower on Twitter, and he is. At Bandana Bro. At Bandana Bro. And he sent a picture. I'm gonna put it over into the 47 talk. I'm gonna if I can find it here. It's really cool. He sent a spooky ghost picture. This is really creepy. Yeah, here it is. I'll retweet this over. And also, I asked him what does he think it is. And he said it's his brother, I think it was his brother or his cousin. They died from alcoholism.
Hey, Wolf.
Yeah?
Don't forget hashtag Be Strange, please.
Oh, you want me to throw that in? I'll do that too, okay.
No. Okay. Sorry, I wanted you to play this.
What is it?
Hold on.
Oh, this is strange, Dave, so you'll like that. Okay, I can post this, and there's a little story behind this. And he asked for our help to try to get his cousin. They just want... Where is it now? They have music too that they, I asked him if he wants to come on, he can play the music that was from his, not sure if it's brother or cousin. But there's two of them.
So somebody wants to kill themselves? Is that what you said?
Okay, yeah. He made me promise to publish his music before he passed. He was 47. He died in his sleep from alcoholism. And this is Zachary Polk. And P-O-L-K. And just when I was talking to Reverend John Polk today, this guy friended me on Twitter. And I'm wondering if they might be cousins.
Did he die, or did you, yeah, he should have called 911?
His cousin Fred has died at 30 years old. Please help me share the effort to bring him home. Now, I don't know what you're trying to do, but you just go to @BandanaBro, and you'll find him on Twitter, and we'll try to help him out. I'm saying, Zachary, if you're listening right now, we want you to call in and share some of that music and tell us a little more about this story that you need help with. But
dang,
either way, go to #47talk or #BeStrange, and you're going to see the picture with him and his girlfriend, I believe, and really weird. It looks like ectoplasm all around them. It's really
my strange. Brother.
Yellow things all around them.
Yeah, you see that?
Yeah, that's bizarre. You see that?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
My brother took his life and just fucked our family up. Oh, God. He ruined our family. Don't take your life. Don't do that to your mama. Oh, God. It messes up our family. Oh, Scotty. How cowardly to kill yourself like that. Do that to your mom and to your wife and your babies. Your babies, Scotty. What he did. Yeah, he's with my Lord now. Everything all right. But what he did, how he scarred our family. Kill yourself, you punk. Have some brass. Live it out. Live. Go through it. Go through the fire. Whatever you have. But don't punk out. Put a hose in an exhaust pipe and
okay, we got a caller, guys.
So
I'm gonna have to take this call. Sorry. Hello, you're on the air with Monster Castle Paranormal.
Hey, Wolfman Mike, this is Zach Attack Bandana Bro from Twitter, man.
All right, you were listening and you called in. All right, man.
Yeah, I tried to get you, but you know, I got this head injury and I dialed the number wrong. I didn't see the numbers right.
That's okay. So can you tell us what's going on there, and how can we help you?
Well, having a lot of last spiritual contact the last couple of years, man, it's been pretty heavy. It's been pretty heavy.
So when you said an effort to bring him home, that's your cousin. Where is his body, overseas somewhere or something?
My most recent spiritual contact, yes, just the last few days. He's with me now. He is my younger cousin. He's 30 years old. I'm 47. You know, when I was a boy, he was a baby. And we all grew up together. And he's not overseas. He's in Georgia. And for the last... Before I found out... 2 days ago, 3 days ago, I kept getting these pings in my mind that I needed to go to Georgia, down the state of Georgia. He drives truck. His dad drove truck, and I've been in a lot of turmoil, and something just kept calling to me, Georgia, 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 Georgia. And I've been doing all my efforts on the internet, on Twitter, because I'm focusing my business efforts there. I feel that's my best interest. And all of a sudden, at the same time, I had a lot of people coming to me from Georgia, too. And I had been working day and night. It's hard to admit, but I can be frank, I've been without medical care for a couple months.
Oh.
And I've been pretty distraught and under stress. And so it's been hard just staying in tune with the life around me. And when you're under stress and you're inebriated, you're not able to receive the signals from the spirit world. And I was getting a fuzzy signal, in short.
Yeah, but I actually have just as good connection or better when I'm intoxicated with the spirit world.
Okay.
And I know it's real, I can tell you.
It can go both ways. It can go both ways.
Yeah, I know it's real because other people see it too.
Yeah, and it's hard for me because I don't know anybody else around me that's close that has those same experiences. And it's very real.
Well, we have Ruth. Ruth, are you there? The second guest
is...
Well, you know what? You got the right person on with you. Maybe you could help Zachary a little bit. Were you listening to what he was...
Yeah.
He's just a caller that got a hold of us and asking for a bit of help here.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Am I
coming through?
Yeah.
Hi, Ruth.
Oh, hi. Great. Hi. Your name is Zachary?
Zachary Polk, yes.
Oh, hi, Zachary. Good to meet you. You know, I just came in and I caught a little bit of what you're talking about, but I didn't catch the whole thing. What's the main concern you're dealing with at this time?
At this very moment, my cousin, my first cousins, there's three of them, Carrie and Wade, the older ones, and then Freddie was the youngest of a different father. And his father was a trucker. Well, Freddie had gotten into a lot of trouble as a child because of his father and not so great of an influence. And he ended up in a lot of trouble. And my family, his older sister, his only sister, called out to me when he was 10 and asked me to take him in when I was doing pretty good. And my wife at the time wouldn't allow it, and I had to say no to keep the peace and maintain my family, and there was a lot of regret to it. I wish I had maintained a little bit more control and not given her so much of it, but he's been working with his dad driving trucks. And they both had health problems, and I'm not sure what the autopsy results are yet. But they think that it was something to do with his heart. But they found him dead in his semi down in Georgia on the 6th of March. And since the 6th of March, or even the 5th of March, because I get these signals before it happens.
Mm-hmm.
Just before this, it was my grandmother, and for days before she passed, I kept getting indications that I needed to, that I was thinking about her, but at the moment, I guess this is about him. I kept getting these things in my mind. I needed to go to Georgia. Something kept drawing me to the state of Georgia. And I've been focusing my business efforts and selling my writing on Twitter. And at the same time, boom, I got hit with a lot of people from Georgia. And then I've been working a lot of hours. I'm getting 3 hours of sleep.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah, and 3 hours and let's just say a light nap, not even mm-hmm. sleep. And I woke up, I went to bed at 7:38 in the morning. I got back up at 10 in the morning, and I jumped back on the computer because I'm trying to sell my work and become affluent enough to take control of my family and take back my grandpa's position as the controller and the person who organizes the family gatherings and kept everybody together. I'm trying to take that over because it's been lost.
Right.
And I'm desperate. And so I'm working day and night on the computer. So I jump up and out of bed and I get on the computer and I decide, let me check in on Facebook and see if anybody's, you know, expecting to hear from me, because I have a lot of influence on a lot of people and people that know me. People that know me love me.
Yeah.
And adopt me as family. And so I checked in on mm-hmm. Facebook and boom, I see this thing there from my cousin saying, this big shocker that Fred was found dead in a semi on the 6th of March. And this was on the 8th. So, but the 2 days prior, I kept getting this draw in my mind to Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I read through the thing, and she started this GoFundMe thing because it's going to cost, well, $6,000 with the GoFundMe percentage, of course, because then some guns get 30% or, you know, 30 cents on the dollar, which upsets me.
What the heck? GoFundMe takes 30%?
No, I don't think that's true. I guess some of the, like, guidance I'd like to give, Zachary, is obviously we can have this sense here of, you know, some guilt, you know, in your system and some sense of responsibility. And I think overall there's something in your karmic path where there's this real kind of weight, you know, of feeling responsible.
Yeah.
And I think this is something you already know, but of course intention in many ways is more important than action. And so if you got that guidance, you know, Georgia, 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 and you feel like you didn't act on it, that guidance might have not been coming through as an action. You know, it might have just been coming through as like a heart message. It might have just been coming through as like a soul connection. You know, this feeling that you and your cousin have a bigger soul connection than this life. And the opportunity you have now is really to kind of decide what type of heart intention, you know, you want to put towards your own grief and your own family and your own work. But it's not going to work yourself to the bone and exhaust yourself, you know, just taking on too much kind of responsibility. Instead, what we need here is like a gentleness with your own heart. Does that make any sense?
And also, I can give you some advice too. Hang on. What I would advise you to do is meditate and put your hands up towards the sky and release that negative into the atmosphere. Release it into space. Release it to Mother Gaia. Release it to the universe, and you'll get help.
Well, and that's just the thing is, it wasn't just the sensation of being called to the state. He has actually been here with me, and it's amazing.
Since he's been there with you since he passed?
Since he passed, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know? I guess I don't know to ask you that you know what pilar erections are, but you know what pilar erections are.
No.
You know when?
No.
When there is a strong spiritual force near you that's trying to communicate with you, one of the first senses of energy that you will feel is not necessarily a cold spot. It's an energy. It's an electricity that washes mm-hmm. over your body like an ocean's waves. Flashing you as you sit at the surf. It's an intense energy that raises your hairs on your skin all over your body. I want to use the word static, but it's not static. It's not the same energy. It's not a static energy. It's a different energy, and I don't know the name of it because I'm not on the other side yet, and I don't understand it. I'm not that scientific. I'm just a layman in this world. But when they are there, you know it.
Yeah.
It's like people call it the heebie-jeebies.
Zachary, my understanding of it is that, of course, everybody needs to go to the light. Everybody needs to transition on to the next place. And often when people die in shock, you know, they don't kind of totally know that they passed, and they don't kind of totally know where they need to go. Do you feel like you might be able to help your cousin transition on? That would probably be the most generous thing to do.
Well, and I totally I'm so at your feet there with that, because I know exactly what you're saying, and I think that what the point here that everybody needs to know is that when these people are contacting me because they know that my frequency is able to receive them.
Yeah, absolutely. But we have free will, so we need to be careful. And I had one teacher one time,
and what she did is she had one night a week.
I'm just going to finish my sentence. That she had like one night of week that she said, okay, you can come and I'll help you transition on. But it's really important that we take care of our own being, and we can't kind of be doing this 24/7. And so we need to be like set really firm boundaries with these energies, and that's the most generous thing we can do with these energies, is to set firm boundaries with them. And so we need to say, hey, like, I love you, buddy. I'm glad that we had time on this planet together, and I really suggest you go to the light now, and I'm going to kind of encourage you on. And that's the most generous thing you could do for him.
And it was Ruth, right?
Yeah.
Ruth, okay. Forgive me. I have a head injury. But I totally understand what you're saying, and I do openly talk with these spirits when they come to me.
You need to be pretty firm with them. They're a little confused and a little lost.
I recognize them, and I try to identify them, and I try to receive the signal to ascertain who is who. I'm not very good at it, but I do, I recognize they're there, and I try to let them know that I'm talking to them.
I don't spend too much time analyzing it. I just say, hey, off to the light you go. And that's it. It's not otherwise any of my business. I just try to kind of give them a hand. Anyways, well, Zachary, it was great talking with you, and I hope you have, a chance to kind of, take some time and take care of yourself. You know, from the passing of your cousin, and I hope you have a chance to help him on with the light. I think I noticed that there's a message here that someone else has a question.
Oh, no.
Well,
that's Dave. Dave, you have a question? I think we have Willie on too, and Kurt with us. But I want to say to Zach also, post your GoFundMe on and put hashtag 47Talk, and you can put hashtag Be Strange, like the letter B and then the word Strange, and I don't know if that helps a lot, but our listeners will see it and hopefully maybe help you. And everyone check out that photo. Where was that photo taken, by the way, Zach?
I was out in full force once I got established with publishing and actually getting the music published out online. I made my flyers, and I was out on force on the community and passing out my flyers and at nightclubs. And I was at a nightclub that night,